So today we're privileged to answer a question not from an individual, but from a class at my church. The Zeal Junior High class, 6th, 7th, and 8th graders are writing in, "Hey David, how do I trust that the Bible is reliable?" Zeal class, that is an outstanding question. And in this video, I have 7 tips and 6 tools to answer that question for you that's coming up today on My Virtual Mentor. Hey, my friend, my name is David. I lead men to go further, faster in their faith in Jesus Christ. And if you're new to the channel, man, welcome. I am so glad that you found us. Listen, every week we just take on a question about the practical life skills, the nuts and bolts and how-tos of the Christian faith. What does it mean to be a man of God? It's like we don't automatically know this stuff, right? And so rather than going to Google or Wikipedia or to YouTube, we're going to go to the Word of God and answer questions like the Zeal class has posed in this one. And so if any of that is of interest to you, I'd love so much if you'd hit that subscribe button. And as a way of saying thank you, I'd love to invite you into a 21-day challenge with me, 100% online. Stick around to the end of the video and I'll tell you how you can get involved in that. Okay, the question from the Zeal class. Okay, well, let me give you 7 tips to trust the reliability of Scripture. Okay, and here's how I do this, man. I have a tip and then I just keep it really super simple, just some ABCs. Keep things very concise and quick so these videos aren't too long. So every tip will have some ABCs, so let's get on into it. The first tip is this, and that is that the Bible is a unique book. It absolutely is. There's no other book like it on planet Earth in the history of the world. The Bible is absolutely a standout book that is totally different. Let me give you some thoughts on that. Here's the first one. It's a supernatural book. Well, David, what are you talking about there? Well, all other books were written by human authors, but this book was written by God himself. Look at this. 2 Timothy 3:16 talks about that. All Scripture, look at this, I've underlined it, is God-breathed. Another translation says inspired, given by inspiration of God. But here, the literal translation is God-breathed. Theopneustos. It's profitable for 4 things: for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. Why? So the man of God may be thoroughly equipped, okay? Listen, it's God-breathed, just like in the creation story in Genesis, God breathed into Adam and made him a living soul. And in John 20:20, Jesus breathed into the disciples and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." In the same way, God has breathed into the Scriptures. And he carried along writers over a long period of time in 3 continents and, in 3 different languages to say precisely exactly what he wanted to say. The author of the Bible is the Holy Spirit through men over a long period of time. And that's why it's a supernatural book. Here's the second thing. It's alive, okay? Every other book you and I will ever read it's not alive, okay? But look, Hebrews 4 verse 12 says, For the Word of God is alive, it's active, okay? You know, you can't get that from a Dr. Seuss book, some fiction, some geography book, okay? They're not alive. They may be helpful, but they're not alive. But the Bible says the Bible is alive, sharper than a two-edged sword, able to divide the soul and the spirit. And then letter C is that it is God's revelation of Jesus Christ. You see, there's ways that we can know God. Number one is creation. God has given us that. Secondly is the conscience of man. We all know intrinsically that it's wrong to murder someone or to lie. We feel bad and guilty about that. It's because God has put that in our hearts. But we can't get saved and just from those two. We can know God only through the Word of God, the Bible. The Scriptures are able to make us wise unto salvation. The Scriptures say, and look at this, John 11:14, look, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. This is Jesus, the Messiah, the Christ, the Holy and Anointed One, okay? All right, well, here's the second thing to consider, and that is the Bible is a truthful book. It contains the truth. Now, that's very important because truth has a name, and here is that name above all names, Jesus. The name at which every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. This is the name that the angel Gabriel told Mary. You're going to have a child. You're going to name him this name right here, Jesus. There's no name like it on the earth. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And look at this, the Word was God. Okay, Jesus and his Word are, you know, seamlessly integrated, inseparable. He is the Word. In Revelation, it says he wears a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. We're talking about Jesus Christ, okay? Letter B, is faith is required. Faith is required. Listen, Hebrews 11:6 says, you know, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Hey, Zeal class, everything that you and I will ever get from God will get through the conduit and avenue of faith. It's by grace we're saved through faith, Ephesians 2:8 and 9. We're healed by faith. We're delivered by faith. We have provision by faith. We get the baptism of the Holy Spirit by faith, the gifts of the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit. All of this comes through faith, okay? Even if it's a mustard seed's worth of faith, you can move a mountain, the Bible says. Letter C is the truth can set you free. Hey, this is a scripture. This is John 8:32, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You know, you can't watch, a James Bond movie and get set free. You know, you're not going to, listen to a podcast or watch a movie or watch a YouTube video or get on Instagram or TikTok or something and get free unless they're pointing you to the Word of God that you get a revelation on. This is what God has provided for us to get free. Free from what? Free from anything that is a life-controlling, addictive behavior or a mindset. Okay? That's what the Word of God can do. Here's tip number three, and that is the Bible is a universal book. Oh, yes, it is. You know, John 3:16, a classic, for God so loved the world, right, that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus. Whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. It's a universal book. It's timeless. All people of all cultures, you know, God has given this book as a revelation of himself to us. God's Holy Spirit owner's manual down the time period, the centuries, the millennia, to lead people to himself. It's also transcends culture. That's the second thing to consider, you know. All people groups, every tribe and nation and people, you know, this word is for them, for everybody, no matter who you are, what ethnicity and race, it is for you. And then thirdly, it's for everyone, everywhere, always. I didn't know what else to say, but this is the universality of the Bible. It's for everyone, okay? Here's the fourth thing, and that's this. The Bible is a practical book. Come on, man. You heard me earlier say it's the Holy Spirit owner's manual, your phone and everything, your computer comes with some instructions on how to use this thing. Well, the Bible is that for our life, right? Here's some ABCs, everybody, to overcome your sinful past. Oh, thank God that we can do that. Let me give you some scriptures here, Romans 6:26, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Where do I get that? We get that right from the Bible, out of the book of Romans, that we can receive Christ and be saved. Letter B, it'll help us not only get past our sinful past, but it'll navigate your challenging present. Hey, listen, I know life's not easy for you. It's not easy for me. It's not easy for anybody. But the Bible says in John 16:33, Jesus is saying, look, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Okay? And letter C is it will help you inherit your eternal future. Look at this, everybody. Ephesians 2:10. He says, it talks about your identity. For you are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God has done, prepared in advance for you to do. It's talking about your future. Listen, God is able to take care of your past, your present, and your future. He transcends time. He lives out of time and in eternity. He is the eternal now. But he knows that we live in a linear experience, and he's provided for that through his word. Here's number five for you. The Bible is a scholarly book. All right, David, what do you mean by that? I'm just going to argue that it is geographically correct. It's scientifically correct. It's mathematically correct. I mean, biographically correct. You know, on and on we could go, and you put it, under the electron microscope, and it will come up to be scholarly correct, okay? And here's some ABCs for you. First of all, is the evidence for the manuscripts. And I can't even do this justice. I'm just telling you, there is more documented evidence that Jesus Christ lived than George Washington, Ben Franklin, Socrates, any person in history that you could name. There is more verifiable documented evidence found in manuscripts. And listen, I can't do justice to this, so I'm going to refer you to a link in the description of, I call it the manuscripts and coffee beans. When we were, my wife and I were at the Noah's Ark exhibit, the Ark Encounter in Kentucky, I first watched this video and I was so blown away by it that I found it on the web and I put it in the description so you could watch it, about the overwhelming evidence of manuscripts for the New Testament. It's just astonishing. Here's the second thing, and that is the evidence for the canon of Scripture. And again, I can't do justice to this. Why are the books in the Bible there? Okay, well, I've got a, you know, I've got a fantastic resource for you. It's called exploregod.com. Oh man, and I put a link in the description for you to explore, you know, the veracity and validity and credibility of the canon of Scripture there. And then letter C is the evidence for the resurrection. Listen, this is, you know, before there was a Bible, there was the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Bible didn't even exist and there were Christians. So you don't need the Bible to be a Christian, because it's the belief in this action from Jesus Christ raised from the dead, and the Bibles, the Gospels are all right about that. And this is the hope that we have in the resurrection. And I've got a great, great resource for you. It's Lee Strobel's, he wrote a book called The Case for Christ. There's a movie for it. I got the movie trailer in the link in the description below. Check that out. Watch this. And he really does a fabulous job in making the case for the evidence of the resurrection. Okay. All right. Here's number six. Almost done. Hang with me. The Bible is a prophetic book. Oh, this is what sets it apart, everybody. Listen, the Bible explains origins, where you and I came from. Okay, how everything came to be and why it is the way it is. God explains that in the Scriptures. Let it be, as the Bible predicts the future. It is a prophetic book. Look, watch this. 3,856 verses tell about future events. That's one out of every six, or 26% of the Bible foretells the future. Now, you know, the Book of Mormon doesn't do that. The Quran doesn't do that. The Hindu scriptures don't do that. You know, the writings of Confucius doesn't do that. New Age writings don't do that. Nothing does it. Nothing. You know, Nostradamus or whoever you could name does not tell the Bible with 100% accuracy. It's compelling. And so that sets it apart. Look at this, Ezekiel. God is saying of himself, I'm going to write it, I'm going to say it, and I'm going to bring it to pass. It's right there on the screen. Okay, God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should change his mind. If he says it, you can count on it, okay? And then letter C, the Bible transforms lives. Oh, yes, it does. My goodness. All right, we're talking about, all right, here we go. Number seven, the Bible is an eternal book. Okay, we've been talking about qualities and characteristics of this unique book, and it's eternal. Okay, and so letter A, here's some ABCs for you. This truth lasts forever. It does not change. Okay, not with the cultural norms which shift from, you know, the 60s to the 70s to the 80s to the 90s, 2000s. I mean, things have just changed so crazy in our nation, the United States. But the Bible, it does not change, because truth is forever. Secondly, God is eternal, right? And we, made in the image of God, are eternal beings having a temporary human experience. And the last thing I would say to you is that we were made for infinity. We were made to live forever in the image of God. The only question is where? Where, what destination are you? You know, the Bible says you live right, you die right, you die right, you go to heaven. You live wrong, you die wrong, you die wrong, you go to hell. That's what the Bible teaches. And so we want to make those choices to live with him forever. Seven tips we've been talking about to trust the reliability of Scripture. And so let me review this real quick, and then we'll close down this video. Number one, the Bible is a unique book. Oh, yes, it is. Number two, the Bible is a truthful book. The Bible is a universal book. Number four, the Bible is a practical book. Wisdom that's as relevant today as it was when it was written. Number five, the Bible is a scholarly book. Number six, the Bible is a prophetic book. And lastly, the Bible is an eternal book. And here's the big idea I'll leave you with, Zeal class, and that is the Bible is a supernatural book revealing God's instructions and plan for mankind. Do you agree with that? Yeah. So let me leave you with a few more to go deeper resources. There's, I promise, six, and here they are. This one right now, I'm getting into a book called Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Okay, this is classic. The update and revised this one. It's just absolutely totally blowing me away. It is like the seminal work for you to find the evidence for your faith. Secondly, is Learn the Bible in 24 Hours, not like in a day, but Dr. Chuck Missler, who's now dead, but he's in heaven, but on YouTube, I'll put the link in the description. This is one of the greatest surveys of the Old Testament, the New Testament I have personally ever been through. I'll put the link in there. It's a deep, deep, deep dive into the Bible. And then lastly is the Daily Audio Bible. Hey, listen, rather than talk about the Bible, how about we listen to the Bible for ourselves? And you know what? 91% of Christians don't read the Bible every day. How about you? This app right here, the Daily Audio Bible, get it on your mobile device and you can listen to the Word of God every day and let it do to you what it's done for, you know, billions of other people and change their life, okay? So, hey, David, how do I trust the Bibles to be reliable? Thank you, Zeal Class. You are awesome. I hope this has been a little bit helpful to you. So, listen, as we close this video down, I've got a question for you. Are you up for a challenge? Yeah, remember I talked about the 21-day challenge. Well, what the heck is a 21-day challenge? A 21-day challenge is a power tool to jumpstart positive change in a man's life. Okay? I have one that's 100% free, 100% online. I call it Launch with David. I'll put the link in the description below. Check that out if you're interested and come on a journey with me to a new and improved version of you. All right? So listen, if you have a question, why don't you post that in the comments below? I do read every single comment. And what do you think? What are some other compelling things that you can add to this that we talked about the reliability and trustworthiness of Scripture? I'd love for other people who read these comments to benefit from your comment, okay? All right, so that's it for today. I'm David, your virtual mentor, reminding you that I'm always for you and I'm never against you. And I'll see you in the next video.